Hey guys, Adam Rose, Vice President, Senior Loan Officer of Western Ohio Mortgage here in Sidney, Ohio. This is another episode of the Mortgage Guy Podcast. And this week, we get to know Nikki Loudenback of Keller Williams here in Sidney, but from Fort Loramie, just for the record, right? So, Nikki, thank you for coming on the show. I know it's, but we've had this for like a year, and we were on and off, like, yeah, I'll do it, right? It's the year of yes, right?
It's the year of yes, yeah.
Right? Why not? I told my coach, I said, this is the year of perfection, and I'm already messing it up. So we're going to do new things this year. So Nikki, could you tell us a little bit about yourself, like background, sure. Where are you from, all that fun stuff?
I actually did grow up in Sidney.
Okay.
So lived here until I was like 16, and then my parents built a house in the Fort Loramie School District, and so it sent me to Fort Loramie. Then I kind of like made my roots there for a little while, kind of jumped back and forth, but Loramie has been my home for probably 30 years now.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah,
so, or more, maybe.
Lifetimer, pretty much,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Most of your adult life. So, so with real estate, how did you get into it? Like, because I know you had a prior career, right?
I did. Yeah.
So, you can tell us a little bit about what you were doing before, sure. And then what kind of like pulled you into real estate?
Sure. So, I was working. So what really honestly pulled me into real estate was my mom was a real estate agent for 20 years in Sidney. She was very successful, loved it. I went with her on a lot of her showings and whatnot. And her and I were always going to be the team. We were going to sell together.
Yeah.
So, and then my mom passed away suddenly in 2006. And so 6 weeks after she passed, I found myself in real estate school. Her broker had called me and said, are you interested in becoming a realtor? I was like, that's crazy. I've kind of been thinking about this. And so timing is everything in
right.
this business. And
yeah.
I finished my real estate license probably 6 months after she passed and like shot out of the gate quick. And it was crazy.
And who'd you start with?
So I started with Emerson Wagner Realty.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So is he the one that pulled you in over there?
He did. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Shout out to Tom Middleton over
that's
there.
That's right. And so that was with him for like 7 years, I think.
Yeah.
So
Tom's still in the game. He's still doing stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's been in 40 years.
At least.
Plus?
Yeah.
Yeah. Good Lord.
For sure.
All right. So that's how we jumped in. And then, I mean, what do you love about it? Like, we're in real estate. There's so many facets of what we do, right?
Yes.
I don't, again, I say what we do because we're, you know, we work together in regards to getting buyers to the closing table, but I don't do what she does, right? But real estate as a whole, there's so many facets to it. So, like, what do you enjoy about it?
But you're in the heart of it.
Yeah.
So, yeah for sure. Gosh, I feel like this is my, I think, 17th year, and it still feels like day one sometimes.
Yeah.
Because it's so, there's not anything I don't love about it. Like, it's so fun to work with new first-time home buyers, to work with just the excitement of finding a home for your person who becomes, like, they start out as a stranger, but then they're your best friend in the end.
Yeah, right.
Because you're talking to them every single day and working through their highs and their lows of finding a house.
Yeah. And every client is different. Every situation is different.
100%.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah.
So, people always ask me, it's like, do you get bored doing it? I was like, well, no, I don't because it's stressful, but every single situation is different. Every client is different. Personalities are different.
Right.
Stress levels, excitement levels, understanding levels, it's all just, you never know what you're going to get.
So
right?
True. Yeah.
It's so Forrest Gump box of chocolates style for clients because we have no idea. So are you working more with buyers right now or
I'm always the 50-50 girl.
50-50.
Yeah.
I like it.
I've always been that like sellers, buyers. I'm always like pretty even. Always have a list in my phone of my buyers that,
right.
you know, my contacts that these are my go-tos. These are people that have been like looking for a specific amount of time and it's just got to be the right property. So I am, as soon as the property hits the hot sheet, I'm like scanning my list. Who needs this house?
So this question is a little bit farther down the list, but let's talk about that. So how do you keep a hold of like what? What's your database look like? Like, what kind of tech are you using? And, you know, what's that look like exactly?
So Keller Williams offers this command program. Uh-huh. So you put your contacts in there. And okay. ironically, I just looked at my database the other day and I have like 1,800 people in there. So it's like a ton of contacts now. Yeah. Probably if you've ever called me, I've saved you.
Right. People that have bought, people that have closed, people that
call me on a specific property and this is what they're looking for.
Wow. Yeah.
It's so I constantly am just trying to like scan my brain on who needs what and where am I moving them to.
I mean, do you stay in constant contact with all of them, like a CRM email style or anything like that?
A little bit. That we have that capability, which is awesome. And so we can send out like blast emails, newsletters, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm.
So when you meet with these buyers, since you're 50-50, because I'll tell you, you know, a lot of people that have been in the industry as long as you have, they always start with buyers, right? That's just the name of the game, right? You start with buyers, and the far longer you get into it, you're starting to get those buyers that you worked with in the past, and you get this large database of people that are ready to sell, and they start shifting towards, I do mostly listings. You've always been kind of 50-50, which that's impressive, because a lot of people have been in the game forever. They're like, passing this buyer on because I don't want to run around anymore. Right. You know, they kind of get tired of that, and they do listings. So that's impressive. So with the listing side, have you seen any kind of like uptick or been talking to a lot of people and they're like, I want a list. It's not quite right. Like, what are you seeing
out
there?
So listings are hard right now because so many people don't want to leave their locked in interest rate that's been low. And so, you know, but there's people still need to move.
Yeah.
You know, and unfortunately fortunately, I don't know, hopefully we're kind of more stable and where the interest rates are and where they're hopefully going to remain. I mean, we would always love to see them go low. But the days of the twos and threes are over.
I don't know if we'll ever see them again. I mean, someone's like, we're going to see threes again. I'm like, I don't think so.
That'd be awesome.
That'd be amazing.
Yeah.
But you know, that kind of created the issue we're in today, didn't it?
It sure did.
Yeah. You know, so, it was beautiful for a couple of years, but then everybody's like, I'm not moving. I'm staying right here.
Right. Well, and even for real estate agents, a lot of agents jumped into it because it became more of a, like, you know, we were at a speed market versus a skilled market.
Right.
Whereas now you have to be a skilled agent to be able to keep up with these, you know, moving times.
That's what happened in our industry as well. Yeah. And, you know, a lot of people did get licensed at the end of 2020 because they saw all the refi boom happening.
Right.
I mean, we were just talking about this on our study hall yesterday with the entire company, how, and you know, the 2008 meltdown, people got out, and then by 2012, people were getting back in that were out for a while, and it gets cyclical in that way. And we were just looking at numbers. I don't have the official number, but the amount of people that have renewed their license in our industry, because we've had a rough couple, you know, 18 months to almost 2 years now since the 2021 boom.
Right.
And it's about 50% of the people that were licensed in 21 are licensed today.
Exactly.
Half of them. It's crazy. And now I don't know if you pay attention to those numbers in real estate. How's that look? Do you know any of those?
Like how many agents?
Like if we had 10,000 agents in Ohio in 21, how many we have today kind of a thing?
So just in Shelby County, we had 99 agents. So this statistic kind of blows my mind a little bit, but every person knows at least three agents.
I feel like that's the case. I felt like you could throw a stone and find an agent.
Find an agent.
Right. I had a client saying, well, do you recommend anybody? And then, you know, we always have a list that we can recommend. And we always tell people, hey, use who you're comfortable with. Because it's that whole RESPA violation thing. Right.
Sure.
And then trying to burn someone because you didn't send it to them. So we have, I said, here's a whole list of people. But we will move on from that piece of it. And I do want to talk about buyers just a little bit. You know, there's so many resources out there that buyers look for on the process of buying a house and credit. And there's a lot of misinformation also, of course. Do you guys have any resources or any resources you suggest to buyers to look into, whether it's preparing to buy or the do's and the don'ts or, you know, what?
I think it comes down to like really communicating with your buyer and educating them on the process, the steps. Like you need a great agent, right? You need a great lender. You need somebody who's going to answer the phone, who's going to communicate. And just, they're scared, you know, they're unsure. They don't know the process. That's our job, right? Let us take on that burden. I don't want them to be scared. I want them to like have fun with this and, enjoy it.
It's stressful because they're like excited to go shop for a house. It's fun.
Sure.
Go check all these properties out.
Yeah.
And then going through the lending process is just stressful because it's so personal. Right.
It's not too stressful.
I'm just saying for some buyers who are like, oh, my God, this guy's going to look at my bank statements and all this stuff. It's like, listen, I don't care what you spend your money on. It's not going anywhere. We're not gossiping about it. No one knows anything. So don't worry about it. We see it every day.
So true.
So that piece can be a little stressful for buyers. But we hope that, explaining the process and trying to hammer down some of the things that we run into and why we'll ask for certain things. And I think they have a better understanding of why we ask for stuff.
Sure.
It's more palatable, you could say, right? Because we've had people fight us back on just getting tax returns, right? And stuff like that for government lending. And they just, I don't know, like we said, box of chocolates. Everybody's a little bit different.
And it's private information.
Yeah.
So you don't like to necessarily share because then it starts to get personal.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So.
And we've heard some stories. So on that topic here on buyers. So, what kind of questions do you ask your clients? So when you go, all right, let's say I'm a prospective buyer and Nikki, you're going to be showing me some houses. What's this process look like? Let's say this is our first time meeting and we're going to set up showings. Like, what do you do?
I want to know your checklist. What's your do's? What's your don'ts? What do you have to have? What's your must? What's your wants, needs?
How often does a buyer really check all the boxes?
Oh, it's so rare.
Rare, right?
And the fun thing about real estate sometimes is like the home that they didn't think they'd love that they fall in love with that you're like, yes, I knew you would love this.
Yeah.
You know, like sometimes I'll literally, you start to know your clients so well, you open the door and I'll say to them, welcome home.
Yeah.
Because I know this is their home.
Nice.
Yeah. Yeah. It's so, that's refreshing and exciting and, it still like gives me all the extra heartbeats.
Yeah. What do you think the main checklist items are for people? Is it bed, bath, count, size? Is it location? Is it?
Because
the guys, I would say probably 80% of the time.
Yeah.
If it's husband and wife shopping, the husband's always like, I need a garage and a barn. You hear that a lot?
In a basement.
Right.
Yeah.
And then they're happy.
Right.
And really it's, I mean, come on, let's be serious. So when I talk to clients, I usually try to talk to the spouse because that's the decision maker in the house.
Yeah.
Don't be dumb agents, right? Talk to the wife. She's got all the answers.
She does.
She holds all the power.
Like,
she does. Let's be serious. I mean, if we can give the husband one good thing in the property, they're usually pretty happy.
Yes, for sure.
But what is the top? Like, what's the main things people usually, I need these for sure.
I kitchen's always a big deal. Garage is always a big deal. Yard can be a big deal. Sometimes it comes down to like fence or no fence, right? It comes down to like, kids in the neighborhood or not kids in the neighborhood. So it just kind of depends on like your buyer and figuring out what is it that they, they have to have. So sometimes I'll send them a house and they're like, hey, it doesn't have a window over the kitchen sink. I'm like, oh my goodness. Okay.
Yeah,
let's scratch it
just for that window. Do you think there's anything going on out there right now that's deterring buyers? I mean, because here's the thing. Mm-hmm. Even when the rates were hitting peaks at 7.8 and almost 8%, right?
Yeah.
There were still buyers shopping.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
So do we feel like it's a limited inventory issue right now? Or what are your thoughts there?
Yes, there is still that. Mm-hmm. Definitely what drives the market up is the fact that we don't have a lot to show our clients. But I will say this. So New Year's Day, I just showed a client 5 homes in Sydney that were like between 250 and like 330. Mm-hmm. I haven't had that where I got to just go show.
You're right. Yeah, that's nice.
So that to me is real estate. That was fun. Mm-hmm. That was like
where you can
click on your feet. Let's go look.
I started in 2012 in lending. And I remember, because houses would normally sit on the market 45 days, 60. That was pretty normal.
Right.
People could go look at the house and then think about it and go back out to the house again for a second showing to give it a decision. You don't really have that luxury anymore very often because it's usually like multiple offer or it's gone in 48 hours.
Right.
And a lot of the agents I started working with, they would have like a day and be like, we're shopping on Saturday and we've got like seven houses lined up.
Exactly.
That doesn't happen very often anymore. No.
Well, especially like if we have to put them out, you know, like if we're not in that house in 24 to 48 hours, we may not have a shot at it.
Yeah.
So there was a time when we could schedule a week out for showings or 10 days,
yeah.
but those days are few and far between, even in this market where it's kind of, you know, shifted and slowed up a little bit.
Yeah, doing five showings in a single day on five different houses for the same client, that was probably a blast.
It was a blast.
Yeah.
And I, like, in my brain, I'm like, where else could we go? Like, is there more?
We got to get lunch before we see the rest of these houses.
Exactly.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah. We did stop for a break, actually.
Yeah. So in your real estate career, we've made some changes between brokerages, and now you're at Keller Williams.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to see or ask, why Keller? I always, you know, when we have real estate agents on, I like to allow them to give a shameless plug for their company.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
And so what's up with Keller?
So, you know, it, for me, it was about like, not the small town boutique brokerages
mm-hmm, sure.
anymore. It
right.
was, this was a national, international brand,
right.
honestly.
It's a very large brand.
Yeah. And it allowed for me just growth and something, an opportunity to like plug into their training, their mm-hmm. technology, their growth minded business of like, I'm going to be super challenged because,
right.
you know, there's not 20 agents, there's 1800 agents. And
right.
that's just in Ohio, you know, or more. So it for me was like growth.
And then you have the access to probably, I would say a lot of
yeah,
other
command
people.
So we can like, quickly, like if I have a client that's moving to Kentucky,
mm-hmm.
you know, Florida, Georgia, whatever, I can tap into this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This
yeah,
big network.
Site and just hook them up with the Keller Williams agent quickly and then do a referral.
That's
and
cool.
I get those back.
Yeah.
So, which is fun.
Awesome.
So,
awesome.
Yeah.
Well, good. I'm glad. And then now, I mean, you started the Sidney location for Keller because
mm-hmm.
there wasn't a Keller Williams here in town.
Right.
I think we had Piqua Troy.
Yeah.
And then they brought it to Sidney.
Yeah.
So how many people you got sitting over there? And
we have 12 agents over there. Yeah.
Really?
Yes.
Is it that many already?
It is 12.
I feel like when you opened, there was like four or five.
Yeah. And... yeah. Well, we initially started, I think, with like three for sure. And then, well, five. And then it like
wow.
just keeps
snowballed.
Kind of and then we have like some that I've been in touch with that.
I got to get better at visiting. Good Lord.
12, yeah.
I'm like a hermit crab lately. I don't know if it's this
yeah.
weather or what. I try to stay in touch via email, but
yeah.
I got to get back to the old office visits. But that's hard too, isn't it?
For sure.
Because everybody's always working at home or
yeah.
not going to have a full-time job and all that. So,
and a lot of agents do. They do, you know, work another job.
Yeah.
Yeah.
yeah. So referrals. So we were talking about referrals mm-hmm. back and forth with Keller Williams agents and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And you are a part of our group at BNI here in Sidney.
Yeah.
Has that had much of an impact on you?
BNI. So I wrote down my numbers, Adam.
Because you're okay. Go
I
ahead.
Am going to actually refer to that. So I joined BNI when it first, it wasn't even BNI yet. We
yeah.
were just trying to create the group.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I know you were one of the first as well. So that has been 5 or 6 years.
I don't
years.
Know anymore.
Might even be
19. Was it 19 when we tried?
19.
Start.
18 or 19.
Yeah,
for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was 18.
It might be.
Yeah, crazy. So
I don't know. They made me president for 2 years, so I was ready to be like, all right, I'm done talking.
You were good at it. Yeah. I know. And then I think I stepped into vice president.
Yeah.
You shifted. But I have closed $128,000 in business
Ooh.
Since joining BNI.
Very nice.
Which I was like, that's pretty impressive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's a plug to the group, guys. And I like
yeah.
to plug BNI as much as I can. Our Sidney chapter, we're roughly a dozen people looking for contractors.
Mm-hmm.
And you name it, the category list is extremely long. So if you own
sure.
a business or if you're a salesperson, you're interested in joining our group, give us a holler. You can comment on our YouTube channel, Facebook, email me, whatever the case is. But I wanted to plug that.
I love BNI.
That's awesome.
It's the best part about Tuesday mornings,
right?
Right?
Oh yeah.
I mean, it's a comedy show. It's it's a business minded group who has a ton of fun.
Yeah, I got a shout out to Tim McMahon because he's usually the butt of our jokes and he makes our mornings pretty
awesome.
Great.
Yeah.
So
love
shout
him.
Out to Tim McMahon.
Loved him.
So last thing I wanted to talk about. is client stories. Now, I've got 36 of them, but I'm not going to discuss. This is not my time. So we like to end with real estate stories, you know, something you run into, something crazy, and you've got one for me.
I do. Right? I'm going to share two, though, because
okay, fantastic.
I know, why not one up it, right?
Yes, let's
do that. So my first one still cracks me up. Like, I had my very first, he's probably my third client, 96 years old, sold his house. He wanted to move. And I was like in touch with his daughter because I'm like, are you sure he wants to move?
Right.
You know, like 96.
What's the
point,
right?
Yeah. Where are we moving him to? So anyway, so he decided he wanted to live on the north end of town and he was on the west end. So I was like, okay, let's find a house. We found him this cute little yellow two bedroom house. He didn't like it. He wanted to move back to his old home.
Oh, no. So he closed, he bought it, and he's like, nope.
Didn't
like it. Can't do it.
Can't do it. So so I moved him again. Like, and then, so I sold his house. He bought a house, sold that house, bought his house. Yeah. Like, within 1 year, this 96-year-old man created 4 transactions. I was like, are we good with,
are we sure we're happy?
I know. And, and are we not, do you not, you know, need to go to a different home or...
Do we need to go to the nursing home now?
Right.
Right. Is this our next move?
Yeah, this was not it.
Yeah. I actually had a client like that who had bought here.
My headphones are slipping.
You're
Sorry.
Good. You're good. Had bought here, and then it wasn't 6 months. They relocated down to, I want to say Georgia.
Okay.
And then they weren't there for 6 or 8 months. They're like, we hate it here. We're coming back.
We're coming back.
It's like, ooh, God. So, I mean, that created a couple of transactions for me. I'm not licensed in Georgia, but nonetheless, here in Ohio.
Yeah.
And now what's the one-upper?
Oh, so the one-upper.
Uh-huh.
Is, so I had a listing and I was showing him, it was like, I want to say it was at least 5 acres, maybe 10 acres, but I was showing a police officer's wife and the police officer happened to be the drug unit, like the drug, the drug talk. And
we know where this is going, right?
So I'm like, we're looking out into the woods and all of a sudden I'm like, I see a white bucket, a white bucket, a white bucket. I'm like, oh crap. Like, do they see what I see? Right.
And we can
they're growing marijuana.
Yeah. Could you see the plant and stuff? Yeah. Like it was full on.
It was like happening.
Okay.
Yeah, it was like full on.
It was ready for harvest. That big.
I was like, slowly back away. We need to leave. So I had to call my seller.
You know what's funny is,
a little issue.
Is today is not a big deal.
You're right.
Right?
True.
It's like, I don't know what the law is and how many plants you can have, but isn't that crazy?
I still think it would probably cause a little bit of a
controversy. Now, did they end up buying that house?
No, they did.
They didn't? Okay.
No, no, but I had to call my client.
And the seller didn't get arrested, so that's good news.
It's all okay.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
So bizarre.
Yeah. You know what? I don't know if that's the first drug one we've had on the show.
Right?
I've had a lot of naked ones where
like
someone's showing the house and they didn't know that
they've been
listening and they were up
there
taking a
shower. We did have that. Yeah. A walkthrough. It was Emerson Wagner. We were doing some walkthroughs and I was like, there's somebody in the shower. Like, again, back away.
Yeah.
Right.
Very good.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for the information. And I hope you all got something out of it. And you buyers out there ready to start shopping, give your agent a holler. Again, I'm political. So anyways, give your agent a holler. If you're out there looking at listing, you know, call your agents and let's talk about the market and see if we can't get your house going. Again, in the market for our side of things, rates are showing a downward trend. And I talked about on the podcast before, actually the new projections are by the end of the year, they're thinking they're going to be right around 6. Some people are talking upper 5s by the end of the year and then in the spring into the mid 5s. So FYI, everything's looking pretty good. So even if you jump in the market now, mid to high 6s is roughly where they're sitting and you can still get a refinance opportunity. So don't sit on the fence because if you find the right house, you might not find it again. So again, Nikki, thank you so much for coming
Thanks,
on
Adam.
And sharing all your information
Thanks for having me.
And insight. And guys, that's it for us this week. Remember to subscribe on YouTube. Check us out. It's free. And check us out on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. And we will see you all next week.